Okay, yeah, welcome to my session. My name is Carsten Ziel. I'm working for Adobe Research Switzerland, which is a very nice place to work for, and I'm also a committer on various Apache projects. Right now my focus is on Apache Felix and Apache Sling. I'm also working on the OSGI specifications. I'm on the board of the OSGI Alliance and do other interesting stuff. But more important for this talk, I'm talking about something from the Apache Felix project. This talk is about building OSGI components. I'll start with the basics, what the OSGI framework provides you, which is the service registry and all the way how to handle with that one. Then I'm going into the components, and then the more interesting part is the declarative services and how to build or develop components with declarative services. And it, the last part will be about the new version of the specification. Okay, so let's start. First up, I have some plain, simple definitions of what a component and a service is. So actually, my definition is a component is a piece of software which is managed by a container. And in Java, this is usually an instance created and managed by the container. And the container provides a configuration and other references to other services to this component. And then a service, that's a very nice definition, I think. A service is a component which provides a service. And in Java, the service is defined through an interface. And the component, obviously, is implementing this one. It can also provide several services, and it implements all of these. And if you want to use a service, you're interacting with this interface and invokes these methods and so on. So these are the two simple definitions. When it comes to OSGI, there are different frameworks to use to develop your components. So it's always a question, which one should I use? I think it's for the development of OSGI, it's more important to focus on implementing your components and about thinking which framework to use. And in the end, I guess it's more or less a developer choice on picking this one or a company choice on picking the component framework. Obviously, it makes sense for a team or for a company to use the same mechanism. Not everyone, every developer just uses what he wants to do. Yeah, so I think it's more a developer choice in that case. And the solution I present is declarative services, which is very good. We are using that for nearly 8 years now and don't have any issues with that. But it's not the only solutions I will show later on. So let's start with the basics, the service registry, which is defined in the OSGI framework. And this allows you to define a service-oriented architecture. There's a central service registry where you can publish your service using the interface name of the service. And interested components can just look up the services from the service registry and then use them. That's a very simple but powerful concept. If you want to register a servlet, a service, then there are some methods you can use on the bundle context. You get this bundle context within your bundle from your activator or other mechanisms. There are basically two methods to register a service, and the arguments for that are the service names this service provides. So this is the interface name of the service you provide. Then the instance, so this is the implementation of the service, and a dictionary with additional service properties. These are the three arguments. And just to have some code doing this, here I just register a service which implements the scheduler interface and also registered with some service properties like a description and the vendor and so on. So it's pretty straightforward to do that. If you want to use a service, again, this goes via the bundled context. So you can get first a service reference and look up the service reference using the interface name. So again, this is scheduler in my case. And once you have the reference, you can get the actual implementation with the get service method on the bundled context. And then you can use the service and invoke the methods You can already see from this example, it's quite a lot of Java coding you have to do, and you always have to check for null and until you really can invoke some method. So it's really a lot code for the simple case. You can also get the service properties of the service and look up the vendor or whatever you're interested in. Just to mention this, there are some service, you can register your service with as much properties as you want, and you can just make up your own. There's some standard properties defined in the OSGI specification. One of them is the service ID, which is a unique ID for the service. Then we have this descriptor and vendor and so on. There's something called service PID, which usually is used to reference the configuration for the service, so it's a persistence identifier. And another nice thing is the service ranking, which is useful if you have multiple implementations for the same service, you can rank them by this value. And if you want to look up all implementations for a service, there's a get service references method on the bundle context, and then you get an array of service references, and you could iterate over that one and get all implementations, use them, sort them by ranking or whatever you want to do. And if you're just using the method which provides you a single implementation of a service, you always get the one with the highest service ranking. This is pretty interesting to know if you have multiple implementations. Then if you want to do some lazy service creation or want to have some factory way of creating services, there's also the service factory interface defined as a framework with this method getService and unGetService. And whenever a client bundle wants to use a service, these methods are actually, the getService method is invoked and it creates a new instance for the client bundle. So it's kind of usually services are singletons, and in this case you have a factory and you have an instance per using bundle. And you just register the service factory the same way you would register your service. It's the same method, but you implement a service factory and register that object instead of the actual implementation of the service. But just to complete the picture, it's not that important for this talk. And then additionally, just to mention that there's a service event listener you can register, and this one gets all information about coming registered service, unregistered services, and if something changes for these services. So if you're interested in that, you can register this listener and get all the information. Okay, so we have this OSGI service registry, which is really very lightweight. It allows you to look up the services based on the interface name. Once you have a service, you just invoke the methods on the service directly. You can either have singleton services or these per bundle services, which using the service factory I showed earlier on. And new in the R6 specification of the framework will be the prototype service, so each client gets a new instance of that service. And it's always good if you're implementing your service that you separate the interface from the implementation, of course. And actually, this approach of the service registry allows you to do that. It allows you all, of course, to separate the registration from the usage and enables all these nice things as reuse and loose coupling and late binding and so on. The usual suspects, I would say. So this is the basic stuff you have in the OSGI framework. This is a service registry. And as I already said, using that one is possible, but it requires a lot of Java coding. So let's see how we can have a simpler, more efficient way of doing that. Especially if you think of OSGI, OSGI is very dynamic in its nature. So the modules, the bundles can come and go, which also means that the services might appear and disappear at any point of time. And you have to code your code in a way that is prepared for this dynamics. So you have to check if the service is still available or not, or comes back later, or whatever. So This is all doable by hand using the API I showed earlier on, but again, it requires a lot of coding and then work and checking and so on. Then when it comes to the service interface, of course, and then OSGI, the interface is public in a public package which we export, so other bundles can actually use your service and import this interface. You version your packages using semantic versioning. And of course, the implementation is always private, so no one messes around with that. And the nice thing about OSGI and the different approaches to implement services is that they all use this common service registry. So whether you're using the manual approach I showed earlier on, or declarative services, which I'm focusing on the next part, or using the other ways like Blueprint, IPOJO, Apache Felix Dependency Manager, whatever you're using, they all use a service registry and then interact. So if you have code coming from someone else, from some open source project using Blueprint and you're using declarative services, you can still use these services and can use your services because everything goes through a single registry. This is quite nice and I think very important. That's why I said earlier, and it's not that important which one you choose. It's just choose the one which makes your development most efficient. You still interact with the other solutions. Okay, so the different solutions we have, there is this manual approach I showed earlier on. There's a service tracker also defined as a framework which makes it a little bit simpler to use, but still it's a manual approach. Then we have declarative services, Blueprint, IPOJO. They're all declarative in its nature and provide you a lot of functionality which makes development much, much easier. And I think it's very straightforward if you're using declarative services, the annotations we have and the tooling which currently support Maven and BND tools. So let's start with the declarative services. By the way, if you have any question during the talk, just feel free to directly ask. I guess we have enough time to deal with that. So declarative service is a part of the OSGI compendium specification. It defines the service component runtime. Short for that is SCR. And usually, declarative services and SCR are used interchangeably. So sometimes people just say SCR and mean declarative service and the other way around. So it's basically the same. We have annotations for that in the Apache Felix project. There are some official annotations in the specification, but I think they are not as good as the ones we have in the Felix project, and I'm focusing on those. And as I said, we provide these different tools. And the advantages here that the components and services you develop use a POJO style, so you usually don't have any dependencies to OSGI itself. It's declarative, and you have a single source. So all the information for your service and your component is in a single Java file. There's no XML, no additional configuration, whatever. So it's really a single source. And it integrates very well with configuration admin and meter type services. So let's start developing some component. Simplest way is you want to implement a component, and you just use the add component annotation, and that's it. So you have your component. But of course, usually your component has some life cycle, so you might want to do something when it gets activated and when it gets deactivated. Therefore, you can implement some methods doing the stuff you have to do and annotate them with the activate and the deactivate annotation. And then those methods are invoked by the container when the component gets activated or deactivated. Pretty straightforward. If you want to provide a service from your component, you use the service annotation and enumerate the interfaces this component provides. So in this case, this is an event handler service. And of course, your implementation should implement the event handler interface and do whatever is necessary to implement the service. If you want to provide several services, you just list all of them, implement all of them. In this case, I'm providing an event handler service and a runnable service, whatever that is, just for the sake of the example. if you want to use a service within your implementation, you can use the reference annotation. So you create a field within your class which uses the or has a type of the service interface you want to use. Just annotate this with reference, and when your component gets activated, the decorative services implementation makes sure that this instance variable is actually containing a thread pool in this case. So it's all you have to do if you want to use other services. Of course, as I said, OSGI is dynamic in nature, so services might be available or might not be available. If you're using, I'm just going back a slide, if you're using this one, then your component gets only activated if a thread pool service is available. And if the thread pool goes away later on, your component gets automatically deactivated. So this is a mandatory reference. But you can also have optional references. For example, if it's not that important that a service exists for your implementation, or you do something differently depending on the available services, you can just specify the cardinality on the reference and say, okay, this one is optional, this one is mandatory, or whatever. And then, of course, if something is optional, you have to deal with that within your code and check if in this case the thread pool is null, and then do whatever you have to do and check that in your code. But if it's a required reference, then again, your component is only active if it's really available, so you don't have to do any null checks within your code. Okay, so then you can register your services with service properties, as I showed earlier on. If you want to define them in your implementation, you just use the properties and property annotation, and, for example, define the vendor and service ranking through these annotations. When your service gets registered in the registry, then these two service properties are set with those values. Very straightforward way of specifying these properties. And then the next interesting part is how to get some configuration for your components. And in OSGI, the central service to manage configurations is the OSGI Configuration Admin. This one handles all the configurations, persists them, and has a service API to retrieve and update and remove configurations. And this one integrates very well with declarative services, because if there is a configuration for your component, the DS implementation takes care and provides a configuration to your component, and you don't have to do that yourself. You get it via inversion of control. So let's have a look at a more complicated example, which has some configurations and configuration values. In this case, the upper part is the same as I showed earlier on, but also my component has a default cleanup period configuration property. So I use this property annotation on a constant which defines the name of this property, in this case cleanup.period. I give it a default value, which is 15, and in my activate method, I'm using a slightly different version, which gets a map, and this is actually the configuration I get into the activate method, and then I just look up the value for this configuration property from the map. The problem in general is that you might not know the actual type used for storing this property in the configuration. So this might either be stored as an integer, as a long, as a string containing the value 15, or whatever. So it's usually a good idea to do the conversion and then check if it's a string, then do it to integer, and so on. And therefore, we have some very nice utility in Sling, in one of our commons bundles, which does all this checking and type conversion for you. And that's then all you have to do. Okay. Configurations can also be updated, like, for example, if people are using the web console, go to the Configuration Manager tab and then change the configuration. And if you want to handle the case of an updated configuration, you can implement another method and annotate it with modified. And this one is then invoked whenever the configuration changes. So we have the activate method for activating the component, deactivate for deactivating, and this update or modified method for changes of the configuration. If you don't implement this method, this basically means whenever the configuration changes, your component is deactivated, a new instance is created, and that one is activated with a new configuration. So it's always, if it's possible, it's always a good idea to implement this method to avoid the restart of your component. So as I said, the configuration is provided through the map, which you can use in your activate method. And it contains a configuration from configuration admin, if there is one. And it contains also all properties you have defined in your Java code. It basically merges them. And you get all of these values. And then we have in OSGI the MetaType service, which allows you to describe bundles or service configurations. And in this case, we want to describe the configuration of a component and all the properties you can configure with the types, with a name and description and so on. And for example, this meter type information, again, is used in the Apache Felix web console to display a nice UI to manage configurations. And if you want to do that, and then create this meter type information for your component, you can just specify on the component annotation meter type equals true, and then add all these additional information like a label for your component, the description. You do the same for each property you have. And this is all the information the tooling needs to generate the meter type information for your component and creates this description of the configuration for your component. And the nice thing here is really you have all the information in a single class file. It's not spread in properties files, XML files, or whatever. So it's pretty good to have it in one place. Just to complete the picture, you can use different signatures for the activate and deactivate method. The first two ones we already had. If you're interested in configurations, use the second one where you just get a map with the configuration properties. But if you also need, for example, a bundle context or something defined in the DS specification, the component context, you can just add them as different arguments to the activate method and get these objects as well. So depending on your implementation, if you need this, you just pick the right signature and get all the information you need. So and the nice thing about declarative service is that a service is by default only started if someone else is using it. So it's really lazy. And lazy is always good, I would say, and usually sufficient. But there are some cases where lazy is not so good. For example, if your component is an event handler, then this basically would mean whenever an event is sent, your component gets activated, gets the event deactivated, the next event comes. So if you have a lot of events coming on, this creates a kind of concurrency problem in the end. So it's good to mark these as immediate components by using the flag on the component annotation. And then your component is started when your bundle starts. Another thing to mention is that with DS, as specified in the specification, references are actually always bound through methods. But early on, if I go back some slides. Here we are. this is not a method, this is an instance field, and I said that this one automatically gets set with the service. But I was partially lying on at that time, because as I said, DS always uses methods, and the tooling we have, the plugin for Maven and BND tools, generates these methods for you automatically, so you don't have to implement them yourself. At least if these are references to a single service. And actually, this is what happens. Tooling generates these bind and unbind method, which just sets the instance variable and unsets it. That's the magic behind it. But obviously, this makes using services much easier, as you don't have to implement these methods. So, yeah. If you want to use multiple implementations for the same service, you can just use the reference annotation and specify that you want to have the cardinality of multiple. And in that case, you have to implement the bind and unbind methods yourself. There are different possibilities to implement them. You can either get as a service reference or the service directly, or the service and the configuration or service properties of that one, depending on what you want to do with all these services. You just pick one of those methods and handle that. And then for each available service, these methods get called and you can use the service. Okay, and then we have this tooling, the SCR tooling in Apache Felix, which combines everything. It combines these stuff from based on the annotations you're using in your classes. It creates the descriptor for declarative services. It creates the one for the meter type stuff. And you have a single source where everything is contained in your Java code. I think that's enough. And if you want to have a look at what this tooling generates, this is DS is actually based on an XML configuration file, but you never have to touch this. This is automatically generated by the tooling for you. But this contains all the information about the available components, about the services it provides, about the reference to other services, the properties, and so on. In case something goes wrong or your service doesn't work in the way you think it should, then it might make sense to check the XML if it's the way it should be or if there was something wrong in the generation of the XML. And if you use this tooling, for example, within your Maven build, you get a bundle out of your build containing your services, your implementations, your components. This XML file is generated. It's also put into the bundle. And if you deploy your bundle, the declarative service implementation reads this XML file, registers the services, keeps track of the dependencies, activates your services and components depending on the requirements, stops them automatically, and so on. So it's pretty nice. Okay. And for the last part, I will show something of the upcoming declarative service specification. If you have seen the code I've showed earlier on, then this is a lot of boilerplate code you write, especially when it comes to configurations and the properties, and it's all scattered across your code. Just to show this example again, in this case, I've just defined three properties, but it takes all this lengthy code here, and you have to do these type conversions when you're reading the property information from the configuration map and so on. So it's a lot of stuff you have to do for just three properties, configuration properties you have. And we came up with, in the new specification, with a way to make this much, much easier. And this is a little bit unusual way of doing things. And basically, the idea is that you define an annotation for your configuration. So in this case, I just define my own annotation, my config, which contains these different properties for my configuration. So I have a Boolean enabled configuration, which has default value true, topic with two values, a username, which does not have a default value, and my service ranking default values is 15. So this is really the compacted version of what I've showed you on the previous slide. So you define your own annotation, which contains all the information about the configuration of your component. And then you can just use this annotation in the activate method. And the DS implementation passes you this, an implementation of your annotation into this method. And you can just access the fields with that annotation and get the configuration. And all the type conversion and so on is done by the DS implementation for you. So it's, you can just directly use this stuff and don't have to care how this is actually stored in configuration admin. It's a little bit unusual, but it's a very, very nice way of doing this. And of course, instead of having a different instance variable for each configuration value, you can just store the instance of this annotation within your implementation and access the configuration values throughout your code directly from that annotation. And it makes your code much more compact and less places of doing something wrong. We worked on this for a long time. I guess it took us 1.5 years to come up with this solution. We had a lot of different other versions before, but now we are pretty sure that this one is a good way to go forward. And if you compare, I don't have this in this slide, sorry. But still, if you compare this one, which is a way you have to do it today, using the available tooling to, let's say, this one, then it's a lot of less code, a lot nicer, easier to understand what's going on, and so on. But there's right now, compared to the stuff I mentioned earlier on, one part missing, which is the meta type information. And this is currently under discussion how the meta type information should fit in into this way of doing the component configuration. This is not actually the current way. This is more the way I would like to see it. But it will end up in any way, because it's still under discussion. So the idea would be that you add the additional meta type information through annotations on your configuration annotation. So you provide the label description for your component, and you do the same for each property you have. But still you have a single nice place to put all this information. And then the tooling can generate everything. Yes? These are all compile time annotations. Yeah. Compile time. Yeah. I was just thinking about if these are. No, actually, these are not compile time. These are class annotations. So that's the other thing. There is compile, runtime, and something in between. So the annotations are left in the classes, but you don't have direct access to the annotations. So I guess it's that version, yeah. Right. All right. So this is basically what I showed on the last slides is what we are currently discussing as the declarative service enhancements. We hope that the final specification of this one is going out this year sometime. It adds this annotation configuration support I showed. It also provides support for the new service scope. We have this prototype scope, which comes with a new framework version, the R6 framework version. And it also has an introspection API, so you can see which components are handled by DS and what their status, if the references are satisfied, and so on. So it now have an official API to do that. And that's actually all I had to present. It was pretty fast, I guess. Are there any questions? We have 20 minutes to kill. Yes, yes. It's just for DS. Yeah.
Blueprint or any other framework, you have to have a different introspection.
Yes, yeah, right. There were some people mentioning exactly that one, so you should have a single introspection API covering all possible solutions. But I think there's already a draft for that somewhere, but it's in a so early state, and I guess it will be very difficult to get this done. So. Yeah.
So you showed that my configuration, that alternative way, the quicker way of doing things. And that would also be sort of the intermediate configuration level where, you know, you could change the parameters and restart your service.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that would be a better interface into the web console and stuff like that, because then you sort of could generate the form off of that kind of thing. Is that something you could, like, put in a separate configuration? Is that something that you might change some of that stuff in different levels of your environments, you know, as you go from a testing frame or a debug, you know, development to a QA to a, you know, to different levels of SDLC to production? Those kinds of things might change, right?
Yeah, I would rather say that if you have different different targets, let's say, you still have the same set of configuration options, the same properties, but you provide it with different values, right? So this annotation just describes the possibilities for your configuration. This doesn't change, regardless of if you put it to testing or whatever.
So
yeah.
Where are those?
And the,
so those are configured from the OSGI?
Yeah.
And level?
Yes. So it's basically the same as you have today. You can just go to the web console and then change the configuration. Configuration is then stored in configuration admin and also provided to your component through this activate or update method, whatever you implement. But this just says the possibilities you have, different fields and with some sensible default values. Exactly, yeah.
So if you, in the update method, you could make the choice of whether you want to restart the service based on what changed, right?
Yes, yeah, actually this is, I'll just go back to the slide. Here we are. I think usually it's a good way if you can implement this method. But of course this depends on how your implementation works. Sometimes it's not really possible or too complicated to do a reconfiguration within your implementation, so it's easier to just restart your service. And of course you can just do that and decide it in this implementation. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Yeah.
And another thing was cool is the optional
reference.
Because you could do, I can see all kinds of cool things you could do. Like you could have a debug service that you would have off most of the time, and then you just turn it on, and suddenly
Yeah, for example, yeah. That's the beauty of OSGI. You can do all these nice things. And of course, on the other end, as soon as you have something optional, it makes your implementation a little bit more complicated, as you always have to check, is the service right now available? Can I call it? And so on. But that's definitely doable, yeah. Yeah. Right. Okay, any other questions? Okay, then thank you.